Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to CMOTV.live, a production of Accent Info Media and a sister concern organization and or platform of enterprise IT world. Today, my guest is Samir Arora, CMO at Syntel. Samir is a business leader with 27 years plus executive management and consulting experience. He has proven track record of establishing and scaling new initiative. He has functional expertise in corporate strategy, merger and acquisition, marketing and technology, business transformation. He has experience of cross-industry vertical across the world. He's also an author, speaker on digital transformation. Illustrious career, he has received many awards, and the latest feather in his cap is Global CMO Leadership Award from Enterprise IT World. Samir, warm welcome to you. And thank you very much for taking out time.
Thank you, Sanjay. It's a pleasure to be with you.
All right, Samir. We are going through a very difficult phase. What has been the overall market sentiment?
So maybe a little bit of background. So I think Atos, Syntel is a part of the Atos group, which is a 11 billion euro group, which employs over 100,000 people. And with a global footprint across Europe, the Americas, as well as Asia Pacific. So we are basically a global company, and clients tend to be mostly large organizations, governments, as well as Fortune 1000 companies in different industries. And Atos Syntel is kind of the enterprise applications and the digital services group within the Atos, the overall Atos group. The Atos group also makes things like supercomputers and high-performance computing systems. We have our own unified communications platform and a huge presence in cloud and digital infrastructure. So I think we have a very wide business. The Atos Syntel part focuses more on the applications and the digital side of the business. So if I look at, if I look at our customer base, which is, for the most part in the corporate side, tend to be Fortune 500, Fortune 1000 companies across different industries. The sentiment is actually very different depending on who you're talking to. So every industry is going through their own set of challenges. Now, airlines and travel are obviously impacted the most. But if you look at companies in financial services, in digital payments, in insurance, they have a very different story. So across different industries, across geographies, and sometimes depending on which week you call them, you're getting a very different dimension, because you're seeing the way the crisis has spread. It has spread differentially across different countries, and even now, as countries are seeing recovery, we're seeing second wave in certain countries. But I think one thing which is common is across all organizations that there is a renewed sense of urgency to urgently digitize the business and at scale. So it's, we've always had this story about the burning platform, right? Where there's an oil rig on fire in the North Sea, and the choice is whether to stay on the rig or jump into the ice cold waters of the North Sea, where the probability of survival is low, but at least it is greater than zero. So I think that's the trigger that we are seeing right now due to this crisis, that across industries, across companies, across geographies, the urgency for digitizing their business and at scale is a common theme that runs across our customer base. And that's something which we see as a tremendous opportunity as we emerge out of this this crisis for us to capitalize on and grow our business and partnership with these companies.
All right. Now, you see growing, shift into the market, remote work, e-learning, online sales, app-based sales, medicine, everything at home, digital. And this is a new normal now. And how the marketeers or the CMOs are going to tap the new opportunity? What will be the strategy to adapt to this situation and keep themselves different to, keep their brands visible, vibrantly, amid this data deluge?
Right. So I think that's a great question, because I think one thing that's emerged out right in the crisis was that digital was always kind of in a lot of industries and a lot of companies was kind of in some cases a reaction, in some cases something that they were, you know, dipping their toes in and experimenting with, right? So it was something like, you know, it was either a independent channel, so you had a digital channel for business, or you had a separate digital line of business, right? As we went into the pandemic, I think most brick and mortar lines of business actually shut down. So literally digital became the only available channel for many businesses and many industries. In fact, so as we see coming out of this, right, digital will no longer be an afterthought or a sidebar. It will actually become the entire business.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that also has extended to marketing. So as we are having this conversation on Zoom, right, whereas otherwise we would have had it in probably in a conference room or in a seminar hall somewhere. So I think marketing also has changed dramatically. So meetings have been replaced by Zoom calls and you know, to be product agnostic, Microsoft Teams and Google Meet. Printed brochures have now been replaced by digital apps. Conferences are replaced with, you know, virtual events, and customer visits, which used to be a highlight, especially in the IT services industry, have now been replaced with video walkthroughs of our campus and our facilities. So, but I think the key thing to understand is, I think the technology is only as effective as its applications, right? We've seen an acceleration in adoption of technology in the sales, marketing, and not just sales and marketing, but even other traditional areas where we thought technology was a laggard, right? So mm-hmm. You look at legal, in contracting, in a lot of these areas, the ability to adopt digital technologies has really accelerated. And that obviously presents a unique set of challenges, you know, and its own kind of opportunity. I think the first is, I think, in the absence of a sales meeting, I think marketing is the only tip of the spear available to the sales force to go and meet a new customer or to go and engage with a new client. So that actually increases the importance of marketing manifold in the salesperson mind, right? So I think what we are seeing is a much greater collaboration or a much greater interdependency between the sales and the marketing function as we go into, you know, emerge out of this into the new normal, as you said, right? The second is, I think, the importance of a effective digital footprint, both at a corporate level and at an individual level, has become very, very important, right? Because I think the way you engage with your prospects, and especially for new customer acquisition, the way the customer, you know, today, just as you did, you know, you looked at a LinkedIn profile before inviting me, right? A customer who I reach out to for a meeting will also do the same. So I think that individual digital footprint, which was usually a chronology of you know, degrees and jobs held, has now suddenly become an individual, not just an individual, but also a corporate marketing statement. It is something that represents who you are as a person and kind of builds an initial image of you and, by extension, the corporation in the mind of your prospective customer. The third is, I think there's a new kind of focus on high quality digital assets. Because in the absence of the physical asset, I think, you know, whether it's a short, high impact video, whether it is a very creative, but, you know, very, very useful functional website, whether it is high quality content in terms of white papers and credentials, whether it is a sales app. So all of these are now were seen as kind of nice to have or wow factors, are now actually becoming the essential tools of the trade for the sales and the marketing process.
Hmm.
And I think most importantly, I think talking about things like analytics, I think the ability to use the insight that you have through all of these channels, right, allows you to create, you know, targeted campaigns with very, very focused messaging on what is most relevant to the enterprise buyer, which is really our customer segment. So you're able to almost pinpoint who your buyer or set of buyers and influencers are going to be, as well as what is the message that you want to push to them through this, you know, through these channels that you have. And I think one very important thing in our business in particular, especially you have very important customer meeting. The biggest challenge is to get the best team into that meeting, you know, because that's what really makes a difference. Because people are traveling, there are schedule conflicts. Now, if you replace that with a virtual meeting, actually you can get everybody you need to get to, from the CEO down to the, you know, the architect or the technical expert or whoever you need on the call can be made available, because they don't have to really, you know, worry about, okay, if this was, if I need to justify a trip to New York, you know, what other meetings do I need to line up to be able to justify that airfare and so on. You know, you have all of these. So all those hassles of travel and scheduling actually allows you to bring a much richer set of expertise into a customer meeting in a virtual environment. So that, I think, is something which not too many people have thought about, but it's actually a very unique benefit of this the situation that we are in right now.
All right, now the marketing, the way marketing used to be handled, the tools used to be used for marketing, is changing and will change also in the future times. There will be very many applications, you know, methodology to be integrated into marketing technologies. So by now, I think artificial intelligence, machine learning, analytics, which used to be used by the marketeers to you know, churn data, has become very, very vital. And one more thing has been added is the bot services, which is right, to automate you know, data that gets generated from different sources. But then these times, what is happening, the data is becoming too many, and marketers are tending to, you know, stepping out of their boundaries. So there needs to be a balance, not too much, not too less. So utilizing the technology and getting the required result. So what is your take on that?
So great, you know, great point, because I think there is, each one of us is suffering from, you know, I remember, you know, when probably you and I were growing up, if you wanted to write an article, you had to go and look in a library. Look for, you know, your finding information was the issue. Today, they just need to go, kids go onto Google. And the challenge is which source is credible and which source is not. So how do you distinguish between, you know, news, fake news and narratives, right? So I think we're looking at a very different set of challenges. But I think what I kind of, you know, we try and do with me and my team is, you know, there's a famous state called redundancy statement, you know, which is the role of marketing is to make selling superfluous. It's attributed, you know, it's kind of a nice catchy phrase you'll find in Kotler, but the origins of that are, you know, Theodore Levitt and Peter Drucker. They said it in different ways, but somebody sort of, you know, neatly captured it in a single sentence, is to make, you know, selling superfluous. And we try and keep this mantra as our North Star in all our marketing activities. So whatever campaigns, so the marketeers and the technologists will come to me with all kinds of campaigns, plans, strategies, and this is technology, this is, you know, this is very good. But I think at the end of the day, you keep a, you know, sort of a single evaluation criteria. Is this going to help sales and influence our pipeline and influence our conversions or influence our customer service, ability to impact that? Or is it just something that is new and cool? So I think we keep that North Star and say maintain our focus on the end objective, which is to influence pipeline and to get growth, right? And enhance our customer service. That kind of helps us balance, you know, provide that balancing factor. Saying, okay, let's do this, and then you try and sort of, you know, have another technology to integrate all of that and yet another to run analytics on top of that. I think we do all of that. We use tools, we use technologies. But I think the guiding principle that we use is, you know, is the smart application of this technology going to help me reach my customer, get the message across, and effectively, you know, at the end of the day, you know, drive revenue and drive sales for us. So that's kind of what we use to balance all these things out. Because every day there is a new technology, there's a new startup which comes with a cool solution. But I think the focus should be on what is relevant and what is useful to do that. Having said that, you know, we are obviously, you know, I'm always encouraging the team to experiment with new things, pilot it out, see if it works, and then kind of, you know, use it on a larger canvas and then sort of take it, adopt it into the mainstream. So there are two sort of levers that we try and use.
Okay. The other thing that you can see, I can also see, is that social media, its impact has been very, very profound on everyone. Not a single person is immune from social media. And marketeers, especially, you know, it used to be a tool for the consumer products. But these days, B2B products vendors are also, you know, OEMs are also utilizing social media to a greater extent. And not only that, social media is getting automated. The bot services getting integrated into your WhatsApp, your LinkedIn, automated things are coming in. So to what extent are you using the social media? What is your advice to the other people, your peers probably on, taking up social media campaigns and social media activities?
So I think I would strongly advise, you know, marketeers to go back and read a book which was written about 12 years ago in 2008. This was a book called The New Age of Innovation. And it was written by, you know, management guru C.K. Prahlad and M.S. Krishnan from the University of Michigan. This is, you know, it's in my view, it is one of the most path-breaking theories in which is defined where innovation and marketing stands today. The summary point in that was a concept called N is equal to 1, R is equal to G. So N is equal to 1 is basically a customer segment size of 1. And R is equal to G basically means your resource pool is effectively global.
Mm-hmm.
So the R is equal to G actually created, in my view, the outsourcing industry, where today everybody is able to have access to a global pool of resources. And eventually it will, you know, the logical extension of that is the gig economy, where I'm a freelancer with certain skills and I'm available to whoever wants to pay my rate and avail of my services. So I think that R is equal to G is really the gig economy. But N is equal to 1 is the concept of personalized marketing, where every customer is unique, right? That's like the holy grail of marketing. And especially in B2B, where what the message I send to company X or a CIO in company X is very different from the message I send to the CFO in company Y. So it allows me, because you know their companies are different, their environments are different, their priorities are different, their focus is different. So it allows you to create that personalized message and product. Unfortunately, what it also does is, you know, so the way I look at social media, and we use that extensively, especially on around LinkedIn and search words and all of that. But I think the way people tend to use it, they tend to use it like a shotgun, where you basically shoot and the bullets fly all over the place. I think the preferred approach or the better approach, in my view, is to use it like a sniper, is to really be able to focus your message, your product and your voice to only the right people, right? So I think you know, people use a scattershot approach, but you know that obviously creates great revenues for LinkedIn and Google and everybody else in the search and ad business. But it doesn't really allow you to achieve your objective. So and I think the how do you make your voice heard above the clutter? How do you tread the fine line between too less and too much? Mm-hmm. Right? How do you discern between news narratives and all of that? But it's only so I think that using a sniper approach is probably is my view a more effective way of reaching out to specific customers, to specific segments, you know, as narrow segments as possible with very, very targeted messages. So I think that's, in my view, that's probably a better way of sort of operationalizing, you know, what you want to do as a corporate on social media, right? Especially if you're in the B2B space. Mm. And this is very specifically for the B2B space.
All right, Samir, it's coming back to your Atos Intel. This question is about you. Marketeers are the storytellers in true sense and narrative makers. The business outcome, the impact directly comes from the marketeers' activities. the story that you are telling to the market or the narratives that you are creating. It's not about sales. Had it been sales driven for any of the organization, there are many companies which flopped, which couldn't sustain in this in this industry, in this on this earth, wiped out. But those companies which had a strong marketing communication and narrative, strong narratives, they survived and they thrived. You know it, I also know it. So what has been your innovation for last couple of quarters, whether the messaging or the narratives changed? How have you managed? What kind of innovation have you added or implemented into your activities? If you can take me through that, will be really
sure. Actually, that's, you know, it's very interesting. So I think in the first 2 weeks of the crisis, right, I think clients saw, you know, a lot of our customers saw their absolute worst case risk scenarios, right? Whatever modeling you could do, you know, the risk management teams have done. All the worst case came through. It was like Murphy's Law, you know, on steroids, right? And the lockdown and the cascading, you know, travel plan made, you know, movement of personnel very, very difficult, almost impossible, rendering any sort of people movement based BCP strategy is useless, right? Because you couldn't move people from Pune to Chennai because everything was gone, or you couldn't move people from India to the Philippines, right? And many expected India to be probably very badly affected. From a business point of view, I'm not talking about the management of the disease point of view, but I think from a business point of view, because we've always heard stories and issues around, you know, the Indian bureaucracy, the permissions, you know, STPI, SEZ permissions and infrastructure, you know, broadband is dodgy, spotty, whatever, right? So we've heard a lot of companies, in fact, were expecting that their India-based service providers as well as their captive entities would be very badly affected. But I think the resilience and the sheer agility of Indian companies, and in fact, the Indian government and NASSCOM, has really surprised everybody. And most companies in the IT, you know, IT and even in the IT-enabled services space are operating at 95-97% productivity literally within days and weeks of the crisis. So I think our company, right, our storytelling has been revolved around two broad themes. Mm-hmm. One was essentially performance. Right? So our ability to go above and beyond the call of duty. We've had some fantastic stories of human, you know, excellence, where people went out of their way, took personal initiative to move into work from home as governments and administrations were cracking down and were getting into lockdown situations, right? To keep our clients' business and technology running smoothly. In fact, you know, we actually had situations where clients came back to us and say, hey, you know what, we want to renew our contract with us because the level of service that you've been able to provide in this crisis situation has surpassed anything that even we could get even from our own internal operations. So that's, I think that narrative has worked very well for us. So, you know, I always believe as a marketeer, and you know, I also come from a business background into marketing, I always believe that, you know, the marketeer's job is made very easy when there is performance, right? Mm-hmm. It becomes very easy when you have a product and a service and a story which has delivered value to customers. The second was, I think, the innovation side of things, which is our ability to innovate. So actually, as an Athos group, we actually created literally within a few weeks a completely brand new set of offerings, which we branded as Future Ready, to support our clients during the crisis and more importantly, help them emerge stronger from it. So I think the first, and this goes through, you know, across different industries, huge number of services and solutions that we created. The example is a telemedicine solution for hospitals. Now, telemedicine is traditionally underinvested, especially in areas like North America, because insurance doesn't cover it. So the hospitals don't find it lucrative to invest in telemedicine solutions because they know that the patients have to pay from their own pocket and ultimately, you know, the sign up of people will be lower. But now it's not an option because telemedicine is becoming the default option for a lot of diseases because the hospitals themselves are swamped with COVID patients and other emergencies. So we had solutions which we created and effectively packaged and you know, were able to get them to customers in almost like a in a box kind of solution. The second was, I think, this remote working. So we have, you know, solutions around digital workplace, and this extended both to enterprises as well as to universities, because a lot of them wanted their students to be enabled. So you need the cloud infrastructure, you need the e-learning infrastructure, you need the physical devices which are managed centrally with the security and all of that. So I think that was another service offering which we really, you know, launched as a narrative and a story, and then branded it and were able to get a lot of traction with. The other was, I think, you know, intelligent chatbots, right? So again, chatbots have been around, but intelligent chatbots specifically targeted for like 911 and emergency response teams, because suddenly a lot of crisis response teams across the world saw their call volume surge. And with people working more and more from home, they were not able to handle some of that volume. So again, that is the solution for that. You know, we have our high performance computing division is involved with several companies, pharma companies, for clinical trials, for accelerating this the development of treatment protocols and vaccines. And then epidemic tracking systems for example, I think we did it for the city of Vienna, which is really tracking the epidemic and contact tracing and all of that. And then, you know, other things which are likely to be more futuristic, which is things like health passports, so immunity passports we are working on. And then for retail, a virtual and immersive shopping experience using AR and VR, zero touch delivery for logistics, you know, digital payments, again, accelerating the adoption and simplifying it and making it easier for companies to take it on and implement. So, you know, whole bunch of solutions across industries and some cross-industry solutions which we branded as future ready. Help, you know, so that was the second sort of one, was obviously the performance and our ability to keep their current businesses going, but also a set of innovative new services which will help them emerge stronger from as they come out of the crisis in different industries.
All right. What is your imagination of post-COVID marketing?
I'll go back to your original, you know, much abused and very cliched phrase called new normal. But I think the reality is that things will never be the same again.
Okay.
I think there are three important factors to consider. One is, I think businesses have now seen the benefits of 100% digital way of working, right? So people used to think, oh, will it work? Will it not? It may not. Let's experiment. Let's pilot. Now people know it works, right? And in most cases equally and sometimes even more effectively than the conventional method. The second is, I think the road to normalcy is neither straightforward nor is it linear, right? So you'll go one step forward, two steps back. We're already seeing second waves in many, many geographies, right? So you'll go forward and back. So there will not be like a point in time where you say, okay, we're all normal, right? Because even with the vaccines, you've seen that, right? You know, you still have polio, you know, 20, 30 years after the vaccine was developed, right? So, and the third is, I think, financially, most companies will take, you know, anywhere between 4, 8, 12, in some cases even more quarters to come back to the level of financial stability that they enjoyed prior to this crisis. Some may never come back, as you rightly said earlier, right? That, you know, it may not happen. So I think my guess is we'll see a sensible hybrid emerging, which will blend the physical and digital aspects.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the important thing is, for marketeers and business people, is how do you build a trusted relationship, which is the essence of B2B marketing, using digital, right? So it will be a trusted digital relationship, is a term which I think will be, you know, between individuals and organizations. I think will become very critical. How do you use technology, but at the same time, don't let go of that relationship? Because in enterprise buying, people buy from people. Because you think of a CIO, if I'm awarding a project to company X, I'm effectively putting my career in that company's hands, right? Because if the failure of the project might impact my performance as a CIO of this of my company. So I think that trusted relationship is very critical. I think what I would personally be keeping tabs on is, how do you use this new normal as we know it to build that trusted relationships, you know, or trusted digital relationship, as we call it.
So don't you think that the trust using these digital platforms also changing the mindset, the wiring that we had, that only face-to-face meetings can enhance the trust or enhance the acquaintance. Don't you think people have started thinking, yes, this is also another platform where we can trust by the on the face value, and
therefore absolutely. And I think the biggest change we've seen is in customer behavior. So if you go and ask for a face-to-face meeting, you will get a meeting 4 weeks out. You ask for a digital meeting, you probably get it next week or maybe even in the same week. So I think the fact that it takes the amount of investment that they need to do to prepare for a meeting and the amount is much lower, because they'll look up your LinkedIn profile, they'll see this, okay, say, you know, fine, let's have a quick 30-minute call or a 30-minute video call. So the behavior change on the customer side is probably as much a driver of it as our endeavor to influence that that behavior, right? So I think it's very unique, but it's interesting. So but we'll have to see how it plays out eventually when things go back to normal. So.
Absolutely, maybe another quarter or two can decide a way forward. Okay, the other thing that I ask this question to every CMO and CIO also, the same question, because money matters a lot. So the investment matters a lot. And the management is now saying all across that just contract your budget, be it technology budget or marketing budget. From a technology marketer point of view, you know, addressing a $1 billion company, what do you think? Is it contracting for you? Whether you are getting that kind of messaging that you have to do more with the less kind of dollar spend that you intend to do otherwise?
So I think you know, CFOs love this, right? Because they're delighted at the fact that there are no physical events, and so they don't have to spend on events, right? So I think there are several line items. You know, if you look at the overall marketing spend mix, there are several line items which have either contracted significantly naturally, not because we wanted it to, but you know, because those events and those massive conferences just disappeared, right? Or became virtual and became virtual at a significantly reduced cost. So I think the digital marketing spend has actually gone up, but I think it's not the drop in the physical activities is so high that you know you're even with your increase in your digital marketing spend, it'll result in an overall contraction of the spend that you're doing, and it may not be due to lower activity levels by design, but it's just the way it's played out. But I think what we've tried to do is to channelize the spend into more value adding activity. So right, like, you know, you would do, and again, I go back to my, you know, my shotgun versus sniper approach. So as opposed to doing a webinar and hoping people show up, you do a custom webinar for a particular client, or, you know, for a few executives in a client. So you're spending money, you're still incurring the cost, and you get an external analyst. So as opposed to getting an analyst into a conference, you get him into a very customized webinar setting on a specific topic which is of interest to the customer, and into that setting, right? So it's easier to do that. It's way more difficult to do it to fly people around and get people into a common room, but it's much easier to do it in a, you know, 60-minute to 90-minute webinar where we get an external expert to come in and weigh in on a certain topic, and then we have our own experts, and the client gives feedback in terms of what they're looking for and what is their business problem. So I think trying to do some of these, right? So I think doing those actually makes a huge difference to not just your brand, but also to the way the customer sees you. And again, it goes back to building those. How do you build deeper and more trusted relationships in the digital world?
All right. There is also webinar fatigue these days. People aren't showing up. So that's another, you know, flip side of the webinars and e-meetings, virtual meetups these days.
Yeah, but I think the moment you say I'm doing it for you, or we will plan it together and do it for you for a specific topic which is of relevance to you, is very different from saying, hey, I'm doing a webinar on cloud, and, you know, why don't you come and join me?
Right?
So
Absolutely.
it's more of a dialogue and more of an interactive session than a, again, you know, shotgun, I'm firing it into the air and hope that some pellets stick. So.
Okay. So my last question is about your messaging. What is the piece of advice that you have for other CMOs or your peers, or some of the best practices you already have, which you want to share with others?
So I've seen a lot of marketeers and I've worked with a lot of them. And I think what I've seen is a lot of young marketeers tend to invest the early part of their careers on marketing techniques and now increasingly marketing technology, right? So while this is great to become experts in their respective areas, I think that transition to a CMO needs an equally strong understanding of the business. And I find that a lot of people are you know, and marketing tends to be specialist. But I think when you get to the CMO level, I think the ability to transcend, be the bridge between business and marketing techniques and technologies is really what defines that role. So my single most important message to young marketeers and budding CMOs is invest time early in your career on understanding two things. One is your business and every aspect. Understand your product, your service, why customers buy from you, what is your value proposition, what is the business model, how do you make money, right? How does this business make money, right? And second, your customers. What do they want and why do they buy from us? So invest time early in your career because that is something you cannot pick up, you know, once you've gone 15 years, 17 years deep into marketing only. So understand the business, understand why your business exists and why your customers buy from you. I think understanding that, especially, this is specifically for B2B also, but I'm sure it's equally applicable to B2C. But the understanding of the business is something that, you know, that marketers need to start thinking about even on day one as they get into their you know, either you're getting into your creative side or getting into copywriting or whichever aspect of marketing you're getting into. Focus on keep building that understanding of that business. Keep questioning the business, your business counterparts on why you're doing certain things certain ways. Right. So I think that would be my advice. And I can say this because I flipped over from the business side. I came in from a consulting and a business background. And then I went on to set up and establish and kind of run this marketing function. And that was one of the inputs which I received from my leadership is that you've been able to bring a business perspective into what is traditionally a creative and specialist kind of a function. And that I think has helped the organization you know, achieve its objective. So I think that would be my kind of sort of humble advice to whoever cares to sort of listen to it. So two cents, as they say.
All right, thank you very much. You know, you spared time, you came in and spoke to CMOTV.live, and thank you very much and stay safe.
You're very welcome, Sanjay, and it has been a pleasure talking to you, and thank you for hosting me.